question. She has a question.
Oh, you have a question. Good morning and welcome to the Fall 2015 Internship Presentations. These are presentations of the students who are about to graduate this semester, hopefully. But anyway, so I'm glad to see you guys here. I know it's been a lot of work for these students and a lot of time that they put in, a lot of effort, but this, I always think that these presentations are a good way to show the what they've done, pretty much. I mean, the papers are here. The papers are pretty good. Most of the papers, at least 50 pages worth of information about their research and experience. But I also think that these PowerPoint presentations are a good way to condense and summarize the experiences of the students. And so in the past, prior to like this year, most of the presentations were done with the professor, and sort of in private with the student. And I kind of thought that that's okay, but I thought it would be better if they'd be more public, you know. Going through several advanced degrees myself, I realized this, the oral defense is a good thing to experience. And although it's not necessarily an oral defense, it is also a public presentation. It's sort of like, you know, presenting what you've done and hopefully defending the fact that you did it and how you did it and why you did it and so forth. So today we have four presenters. The first one will be Xiaomin. She did her research in Australia. She also did some traveling to Iceland as well. I don't think that's included in this presentation, but she's somebody who just can't stop traveling. Anyway, so without further ado, Xiaomin. In 1992, and it in 1996
they said it's the oldest wine in the world, and it's really popular, and it's really mature compared with other programs. And in 2002, they renamed as the Ecotourism Australia, this company. And now they have, they already certified 500 operators in Australia, and it contains 1,500 products, like the hotels, the tourist attractions, the sightseeing, something. And it's focused on the Queensland, the area they located, but it's almost focused on whole Australia. But this year they are going to go abroad, go international, because they just got approved from the GSTC, the Global Sustainable Tourism Council, and they just have a contract with one of the country in Asia Pacific area, and they want to import their eco certification to help the local tourism. And there is also the visitors from Taiwan. They want to import the eco certification to help the Taiwan, the tourism in Taiwan. And it's kind of, they are going global now. Yeah, it's a small organization. The staff is only four, the CEO, the operator, manager, the certification manager, and the accountant, and there are a bunch of interns around the world come from the another country to help this organization. It's a really small organization, and
that's my desktop.
Yeah, that's the CEO, and this is the operator manager. That's the stickers. They will mail the stickers to their operators. Yes, the main certification program, it's the eco certification. This one is the oldest and really complicated compared with the other one. And the next is the respect our culture. It's focused on the culture, this area, and the climate action. This one is pretty new, and it's focused on the climate change. And the eco guide certification, this one is focused on the tour guides, how they educate the tourist. There's the logo of the eco certification, the nature, the eco, and the advanced. This one is basic, and it's kind of middle level, and it's higher level. The main criteria is focused on this eight area, and the core part is environmental management. And for the basic level, you only need the 1, 2, 3, 4, the four sections. And then the middle level, maybe add the 5 or 6 section. And for the higher level, you have to do all these criteria. They have the workbooks you collect. They are focused on the certificate, the products, not the business. But the higher level, they do a little bit about the business, focus on the maybe 7 or 8 sections. Yeah, it's kind of the sample of their workbook. They have criteria here and a kind of description, and you tick. And they have logos in the top to help apply the people to recognize which part they have to do and which part they don't need to do. They have very good criteria. For example, this one is very specific, and it focuses on the wildlife, the impact of the vehicles, the boat, review it, and if they grant it, they will send the editor to go to your site to do the editing. And they are not doing editing. They work with this organization, Council of Interim Volunteers. They are the third party to help them to do the editing. They have volunteers from all over Australia. So it's kind of the document you have to support. So different levels of certification, you need to submit different documents. And there is a repeat start. For example, you already got the certification like Eco1, and you can, if you want to get climate action, you only just need to finish several questions, so you don't need to go whole process again. It's the cost of the certification, it's Australian dollars. And according to my research, the most operator is in the like the 1, 2, 3, the top three levels. There are maybe 300 operators. They are not really big. The folks are very small or medium.
Those 300 operators, are they in Australia or?
Yes. If you get a certification from the Ecotourism Australia, it's kind of extending the permit of the license. So yeah, they prove this from government. And the changes before and after, I did the interview with the manager and she told me, so they have to submit so many plans, and the business, if they never did the environment manager before, they will have the samples and they will follow it. Probably this process, they will rethink their business, what kind of things we can do, and what kind of things we can add to help protect the environment. It's kind of directly or indirectly to help the operator to rethink their business. And but for the real changes, it's kind of question because they certified the product, not the whole business. So the business, they may have great one product, but they may have not very green other products. So it depends. So the differences are the unique characters in this area. So the first is the location. It's kind of big island and separated with other continents. And they have unique species like the kangaroos, the koala bears, and the unique geographic views. And in 2014, they have they contribute about 3% Australia GDP, so it depends on the tourism. But the eco, I'll talk later. And they launched a program about tourism 2000.
percent of GDP right now? Do you know how much that is? If it's they're projecting 140 billion in 2020, do you know what their existing value is? Be significant to see the difference as it grows.
It's a big part.
Morning.
And so far, it's even the tourism gets a lot of support from the government, but they are not the tour operators. They are certification organizations, so they still have some problems about the finance. And they need money to, because they work with third party, they need money to support, and they have to travel, and they have to upload all the equipment, and it feels that before this year, their economy kind of really bad, but since this year, they changed the CEO several years ago, and the economy goes a little bit up. Especially this year is can earn the profit, so they have money to do other things. And for the greenwashing, I think it's a byproduct of the sustainable this whole industry. We cannot neglect this kind of issues. But if you do the right things, you earn the money, and you can reuse and refund this. Those money to help protect the environment. And the next is human error. Actually, I did so many mistakes because there are so many people, they told me the different things. So one is this way, one is this way, and another is this way. So I'm kind of confused when I make those stickers or those stuff. And the different interns from the different board, different college, they have a different people every year, so they have different cultural background and different ways to process this whole works. And there are now next is the internal sustainability, so it's kind of green business, but now. They try to improve their own recycle, track their energy use. Now they are working with the local university to help them build a kind of a program to track their energy use and the water waste use. So they are going to be real green. Another one is potential inequality. So there is a possibility for their the benefits between the old customers and the new certificate people. So maybe have some potential equals between them. And another one, I found so many suspend and cancel cases. And during my internship, there are some operators, they email me and they want to cancel the program, and they didn't get the things they want, and but there are some cases they cancel first and they go back, probably because kind of they are popular now, and so many operators want to go back. So my recommendation is. The first one is focused on now they have a very stable market in their national, so it's time for them to go abroad, and maybe they have the similar companies in Australia, they have a strong competition, but I think they have their strengths, and they can start to focus on the Asia Pacific area and gradually go another countries. Airbnb, the Uber, because this kind of new sharing business is so popular recent years. And many people, they choose Airbnb, and Airbnb in Australia is kind of a really big market, and the hotel, those accommodations, they feel the pressure from this kind of shared business. They have problems, so I think it has potential opportunities for certification organizations to monitor those business. And the next, I think it's always the important one for the sustainable industries like education and inform the public. If they know these logos, they will maybe to when they choose their travels, they will look for this certificate operators. And then it's complete their current internship program and improve their internal sustainable, like recycle, tracking the energy. This one is a green map system. It's the basic on the Google map, and they will collect the local information box with the locals, communities, schools, and they will collect the, they have different icons to, for example, they will collect the recycle areas, the certificate business, the green restaurant, those all a bunch of green business or the green stuff, and they will put those things in this map. So people will follow this map to do their green travels. For example, if I want to have a dinner in green restaurant, I will look at it and they will come up from the map, and I will go for to check it out. And so far the Ecotourism Australia, they have a kind of green travel guide. So they have certification type and the eco experience you are looking for, and the different states. You can choose, for example, the green travel leaders and the
there's
innovation.
There's a pointer on that, Shannon. There's a light. It's the bottom one. There you go. A little easier for you.
Yeah, you can choose the type and the state and what kind of eco experience you want to use. And after that, there is a map here to give you the location and all the information about the certified operators. So it will, in future, maybe they can import the green, like the green map system, and combine to this green travel guide, this worksheet, and combine them together, or maybe create some apps to help the travelers so they can just use the map, use their apps on their phones or the computers to find the what kind of experience they are looking for, and, or what kind of certificate organization or tour operator they want to choose.
I'm Joseph Dorsey, I'm the internship director, and this is our second presentation by Karina Becerra. She's going to be talking about her research, I suppose, in Colombia, but is it also including what you did in So she's done a lot of work with indigenous populations. I actually have a own business online that you can market their products for economic development.
And I'm going to be peddling product later.
So anyway, she has, as she told me, a fairly lengthy presentation. So without further ado,
thank you.
Is this that
right? Okay.
Well, before we start, I just want to acknowledge the fact that I'm co-supervisor.
Yes. And a wonderful one.
With our,
let that be our record.
Rebel.
Yes. Yes, and thank you everyone for being here, and especially my two advisors and Dr. Rebel, who trekked over from anthropology. So my research was on indigenous peoples' economies and environmental. broad topic. So I'm jealous of Xiaomin, who was able to do something very focused. So the structure of this presentation is going to be a little more open-ended and hopefully include a little bit of a conversation with you guys. This is like the perfect audience. This is exactly what I pray for.
What little animal are you holding?
That's a little native squirrel. And this particular community had a lot of like native pets, like different tortoises and parakeets, and you know, just very fond of like native pets. So the motivation for my research was a concept that I came across in ecology in undergrad, and I've been thinking about it for 10 years. And it's the concept of the keystone species. The keystone species is a species in an ecosystem that is disproportionately important in that ecosystem. So that if you remove it from the ecosystem, the whole integrity of the ecosystem is at jeopardy or may even collapse. So does anybody want to guess which is the keystone species in this picture? Or do you know what it is?
The mouse.
Patrick.
The tortoise.
The tortoise. And do you want to tell us why?
Because it digs those holes and it provides homes for all these other animals.
Exactly. homes and also protection, so temporary homes, exactly,
yeah.
When our fire-dependent ecosystems burn, which is a very important part of the ecosystem. It's a good part of our ecosystem, of pinelands particularly, but then the animals need a refuge. So that's why the tortoise is disproportionately important in that ecosystem. If you were to remove it, it would jeopardize the whole entire set of animals. So there's other keystone species, like top predators are some examples, beavers are examples, pollinators, things like that. And so my question was, can that concept, the keystone concept, be applied to global sustainability? In other words, is there a segment of the population, the human population, that is disproportionately important in helping us achieve a more sustainable path? And if so, how can we partner with those populations, and why is this relevant? So let's knock out the relevance part, and then we can just focus on the other two. So who wants to take a guess? Why is this question important? Like, who cares? Why do we want to identify a very important population when pursuing a specific goal?
It's probably the biggest influence on both the impacts as well as the development.
Yeah, they're going to have a disproportionate impact. And because we only have limited resources allocated towards sustainability, we need to make sure that those resources, whether it's human capital or financial resources, go to the part where they're going to be do the most good, so you get the most bang for your buck or your time or whatever. And so that's going to be the first part of the presentation, is answering the question, is there a keystone community for sustainability? And then the second part is, if there is one, then how do we team up with them? How do we partner with them? So apparently this wasn't like that brilliant of a question, because somebody else asked it already. And the United Nations came up with not one, but few major groups, 9 in total, who are key sectors of society in relation to achieving sustainability goals. And those are that. And not one is more important than the other. But my interest, again, was in indigenous peoples. And so that's what we're going to be talking about today. So the hypothesis was that indigenous peoples with an S at the end, are keystone populations. And we want to look into why. And so the first thing is to define who indigenous peoples are. There are hundreds of definitions out there. I like this one. And we're not going to go through it all. But it's the peoples that are descendants of those peoples that came into an area first, who were the first to settle a geographic area. So those are indigenous peoples. And there's other things to fill out the picture, like sometimes attachment to ancestral lands, modern subsistence economic arrangements, things like that. Maybe still a language, their own distinct language. There's also the undefinition. And so there's this position amongst indigenous leaders that they reject a definition of indigenous peoples precisely because there's no way to put it in a box what it means to be indigenous. So it's really up to them to identify themselves as indigenous and to identify membership in their communities. So there's no one way to be indigenous. and there's certainly no one list of Indigenous values. However, we do see some common themes emerge amongst different Indigenous populations, and they fit really nicely into the three pillars of sustainability, which are economic, social, and environmental. And so to give you an idea, we won't go through all of these, but for example, Indigenous populations, many of them, not all of them, and certainly not all individuals, but as nations, they are known for frontline resistance to extractivist economies. So you see them taking the position of fighting industrial scale mining operations, oil extraction, things like that. From the social perspective, they have consensus governance or collective decision making. Again, I think that's critical when you're talking about achieving sustainability, and you see that in the talks in Paris right now, where we're trying to build consensus around something. It's really hard, but this is something that is embedded already in their cultures. And in the environmental arena, you see indigenous peoples who are known for their millennial knowledge about nature, and this is not romanticizing indigenous cultures, it's just that they are indigenous because they have been in that area longer than anybody else, and they have established these ecological connections with the land that just make them the best managers of those ecosystems. And to show that, they are stewards of up to 80% of the biodiversity in the world, and that's not by chance. Again, it's just a trial and error way of life that has worked, and that's why they're still around. Something else that I found out that I wasn't expecting was the link between cultural and biological diversity. So there's a very strong connection between maintaining diversity of culture and maintaining biodiversity. And can anybody guess why? I was like, that makes total sense, but why? So does anybody want to think?
Biodiversity of land and plants?
Yeah, of like organisms and ecosystems. So biotic and abiotic resources.
Because they know the land that they're working in, so they know the seasons, they know the soil type, they know that coffee grows better in their shade.
And I would say that's totally accurate. It's their very nuanced knowledge about very specific environments, which again was developed over thousands of years. So yeah, right on. So it's basically, it's just we need a wider range of human resources and capacities to pursue the common solutions that are needed for sustainability. So not just one worldview, like the mainstream worldview, but many worldviews that understand nature in that way. And because there's 5,000 different indigenous cultures, more or less, they account for most of the world's cultural diversity, even though they represent a numerical minority. So it's very important to protect these cultures because it's directly, well, for many reasons, but also because, in this context, because it's connected to biological diversity. So a little bit of the background. So that makes sense to us. We're like, yeah, that makes total sense. But it wasn't always the case. We have gone through a big change, and it's still going on, just in the last century, the 20th century, from the 1900s to the turn of this century, where sustaining our ecosystems and sustaining our natural capital, and I'm going to use that interchangeably with conservation, so conserving our natural capital or sustaining our natural capital, has taken many different shapes. And so in the early 1900s, and even before that, we see a model of conservation that's been called old school or top down, right? Like top down. And colonial fortress conservation, the Yellowstone model. So that means going somewhere, bam, declaring a protected area, could be like a national park, kicking out the people that were there before and protecting that area to the exclusion of those communities. That was the model of conservation in the early 1900s, again, after the Yellowstone model. There is a lot of controversy with that, and I'm sure you can imagine why. The new school is community-based conservation or community-based natural resource management, and so we go from or bottom up, where like the communities are leading the conservation efforts instead of like the governments or the elites declaring an area protected. And I can totally relate to this, you know, because I go to national parks and like I'm like, yeah, this we need to protect this. So I understand both sides, but my viewpoint in this research has migrated this way. So you have also where on this side, conservation and economic development were incompatible, like totally unrelated. It's not conservation's job or the scientific community's job to address economic issues, whereas now we see an integration of conservation and economic development for good reason. And so this one was more attempted to be just science-based, where now it's indigenous or local knowledge driven. Not really, but that's the idea. That's where we would like to be. This one's more linear. This one's more like a systems thinking approach. Linear and reactive because you are reacting to a problem, which is the degradation of the environment. This one more proactive because you're addressing the problem, the degradation of the environment is caused by a ruptured economic system, a model that doesn't work. And so when you are integrating economic development into conservation, you're acknowledging that the problem is the economic system, not the people. Certainly not the subsistence level people. And in the meantime, in this time frame, in this timeline, you see governments passing tenure of land to communities, and that started in Latin America, like in the 1970s, but it cut off by Africa to Africa. A few decades later. So you see this wave of, you know, going back to the communities for those sustainability and conservation goals. That was a lot. Are you guys okay? Okay, and so the assessment is, well, so does this new model work? And we have to move back a little bit and recognize that as the number of protected areas has increased, so has forest degradation. And so something's clearly not working, or maybe it's not enough, and we need to, you know, a complement to that. There's growing evidence that local community-based entities are as good or better managers of forests than governments, and there is also a reason for that. Maybe governments don't have the resources to implement enforcements to protect those areas, or maybe local communities just have more incentives because it's their land, and they know the land better also. However, we have to admit that some communities have translated land ownership into effective forest management, and others haven't. That's the reality. So it's not like it's a silver bullet, you know, give the land back to the communities, it's gonna work, not always. And so I give an example here of the Mayan Biosphere Reserve, but we're gonna skip that for now, and we can come back to it if you guys want, like, case study type of thing. Okay, and so the explanation is, well, why doesn't it work? If you give the land back to the community for management, what are the causes that doesn't work? It's easy to say, well, it doesn't always work, you know, but it's helpful, I think, to identify some of the reasons. And the first one is insecure property rights. So if you don't own the land legally and enforceably, you have little incentive to sustain it for future generations because you don't know if you're going to pass it down to your kids, you don't know when it's going to be taken away from you, so you don't have incentives, but you also lack the tools to regulate that land use. So it's easy to someone tell you, you're in charge of the forest. But if you don't have the legal titles, it's hard to regulate. So outsiders come in, they try to use their resources, and they're like, well, what are you gonna do? You know, how do I know this is your forest? So there's a lot of conflict in that area. Also, there's historical and political discrimination through inadequate policy. So for example, governments, many governments have a policy frameworks that prefers agriculture to forestry, or that favors agriculture over forestry for many different reasons, and that favors large producers over small producers. And so there's that policy glitch that needs to be addressed at some point, and also the poverty issue. People might know the environment, they might know how to use it sustainably, but if you are not meeting your basic needs, that's not gonna matter, because you need to meet your basic needs first before worrying about sustainability. And so that causes communities to overexploit resources, even if they know that it's not the appropriate thing to do. But, you know, we're all human and we all need to survive. And apparently, the world and international community has caught on to this trend. And so you see this is a list of the top 10 donors and recipients also of biodiversity aid. So what projects are being funded? In the top 10 countries, we see Colombia, which is of particular interest to me. And you see that the strict aid, so the one that is funding just biodiversity projects, like let's just conserve, you know, X species or, you know, that just biodiversity, you see it at $61 million over almost 30 years, but many times that's what, like $500 million, which is really not a lot. I think Colombia gets like I don't know, 10 times more in just like to fight the drug traffic, you know what I mean? And it's like, and we get that much for like community development and conservation, but it's still, in relation to that, it's a lot higher. So we see that trend really taking hold. That's what organizations want to be funding, or at least these organizations. So I think that's a good thing. So in summary, there are elements in many indigenous nations, not all, which are key to sustainability initiatives. And these are core values, the cultural, intellectual, and natural resources, the leadership and track record, and the leverage for financing of conservation projects. Because now, all of a sudden, all the NGOs want to team up with like an indigenous or local community. But they need the buy-in of the community to be able to do that. So they have that leverage. When I talk about leadership and track record, I just wanted to mention that it's funny that there is this tension between conservationists and indigenous groups, and it's a big one, and again, you see it in Paris in the talks right now, because indigenous peoples are the original conservationists. They have been protecting areas for thousands of years in the form of sacred natural sites. So they kind of came up with a model. So new type conservation is kind of appropriating not just their lands, but also the idea of protected areas. So we have to recognize the contributions of indigenous peoples, both in leadership and track record. And I'm going to end this section with a quote from the United Nations that recognizes that indigenous peoples are at the cutting edge of the crisis in sustainable development. Their communities are concrete examples of sustainable societies, which have historically evolved in diverse ecosystems. So did we answer the first question? Is there a Keystone community? Do you buy it? Sort of? Okay. You guys are great eye. The second part is, how do we best support and partner with these indigenous nations then? If we have identified them as, you know, legit partners that can lead the way, then how do we best support those nations? And so that's where the internship destinations that I selected came in. I wanted to do the field study. And so there was two. I found an organization in Colombia, the Environmental Heritage Foundation, we're going to call it Fundarencia, and one in the Pacific Northwest called Ecotrust, who are working on different initiatives with indigenous nations in their areas. And so the first one was in Colombia, with a no, and I wanted to give you an idea about Colombia by the numbers and why. I mean, I'm from Colombia, I've been there a million times, I grew up there. It's like, you're going to Colombia again? You could go anywhere. And I'm like, yes, but Colombia is one of the most biodiverse countries. No, I'm sorry. It's the most biodiverse country by area unit. So considering it's a mid-sized country, if you take it by area unit, it packs the most diversity per square inch or whatever. So not the most biodiverse. I think Indonesia is the most biodiverse, but it's bigger. The other thing interesting about Colombia is that it's one of the 15 countries accounting for 90% of the world's forests. So I don't know how many countries there are. There's a lot of countries. Just 15 of them account for almost all the world's forests. And Colombia is one of them. And from those 15 countries, it's in the top three for private community indigenous forest ownership, only after Mexico and China. So 46% of Colombia's forests are owned privately by indigenous people. So it's not a government setting aside land, which is very different from having a title. So very high. Doesn't mean that these rights are always respected, but it's a huge step. We have nearly 100 ethnic groups, and Colombia was the first country to strengthen community forest tenure in the recent legal reforms. So in our 1991 constitution, we changed and amended the constitution to include indigenous land rights. So the first stop, well no, this was the second stop. The first stop was a little fun. But the first official stop was Santa Marta, which is a convergence point for indigenous populations. It's a really interesting spot on the Caribbean coast. And it's also the headquarters for the organization where I was working, but I didn't stay there long. I stayed there for like a week working at the office.
because then I hopped on a bus, and this was really special because I went to go visit an Indigenous community, and this was unheard of 5 or 10 years ago. This used to be a red zone, so 4 or 5 hours on a bus heading south into the Sierra to the southwest flank. This was impossible to go to. Total red zone, paramilitary and guerrillas. Yeah, unnamed atrocities that we won't get into, but now it's this. It's just amazing and beautiful. And that was the last stop before starting to enter the Indigenous reservation, which is the Xiaomin in Spanish, but they call themselves the Ibizapi Indigenous peoples, and this is their reserve. And so this is an example of like something that he's hunting beautiful, like I think it was like a red-winged blackbird or something, and you know, you're like, oh my god, it's like, no, this is a worldview, a form of life that has worked. You're a birder. It's not that big of a deal because red-winged blackbirds are not, but you know what I mean.
Survival as opposed to a grocery store.
Yeah, exactly. However, I mean, they eat wild songbirds, but they reject what they call a gallina. Gallina purina. Yeah, so like industrialized chicken. So this is a community that is like going hungry, and I'll show you some pictures later. But they reject, on an intellectual and ethical level, the production of industrialized chicken. Very interesting. Things to take note of. So this was the part of, we got to the community, this was the gifting and developing our relationship. So I was representing the organization, and my job was to get close to this community before you even start discussing the payment for ecosystem services program that we were there to talk about and stuff. So you gift, you talk, you play with the kids. It's just establishing a closeness. And also conducting a characterization for a pilot project that the organization was looking to implement, and they thought that this community might be a good community to start the pilot project, and it was a pilot project for payment for ecosystem services. So a way to compensate them for the services that their forest provides. It was like 20 families and 200 hectares, so 10 a head. It was good. The second part of the internship was in Ecotrust, that's in Portland, Oregon. And so this is our little internship station. But very interesting, this is the guy. This organization was started by Spencer Beebe. It's the third one that he starts. He started the International Program for the Nature Conservancy, so huge. And so when you think of Nature Conservancy, you think colonial conservation, fortress conservation, right? Like declaring areas protected. Then he was like, I don't know about this. And he started Conservation International. He is the founder of Conservation International. And he was like, a little too old school still. And then he started Ecotrust. And look what, this is like a hardcore organic intellectual. Where is the book? Maybe I have it somewhere. And this is what's hanging on his wall, a logger, you know? And it's like, the logger was once a breed apart and now a dying breed. I mean, honoring the local communities that live off the environment instead of pointing fingers or scapegoating them. You know what I mean? Like, this is not the problem. The paid minimum wage to cut a tree is not the problem. And we need to recognize that. So the project that I was working on was called the Native American Economic Sovereignty Initiative, and that was developing a fellowship model for indigenous nations, the Pacific Northwest has many, to try to build capacity in their communities on their own terms for economic development. That's it. I was like, oh, for the goal of conservation? No. Not statedly, at least. And I was like, okay, for what? For whatever they want. You know, like developing the economies in Native America, basically. And I think tacitly, they believe that that's going to lead to sound forest management in their communities. But first, you have to develop those economies. And so how can we support you? How can we build the capacity in your communities? I know this is a lot. Stop me if I'm not being clear about something. You good? OK. And so part of that, so this is the guy. And so this was the Sequoia Forest Repatriation Center. ceremony. This was in the Coquille tribe, reservation of the Pacific Northwest. So this forest came back into their hands after almost 200 years. They were able to buy it back with casino money. Yes. And so that's why you got to see the whole picture. Like, what? Okay. Yes. So I was able to, we can take questions. Okay. So I was able to observe some common threads. This is not a scientific study or anything. It was just observations that I made between one indigenous community in Colombia and the other one in the Pacific Northwest. So sophisticated consensus-based governments, dwellings that blend in, you know, so designs of their architecture, commitment to food security. So it's hard to see here, but they plant a lot of their gardens. So they have mangoes, corn, boñato, all that stuff. And this is salmon that's being cooked by the fire, also local salmon. And everything was sourced from there. The green salad, this was a big potlatch community to celebrate the forest repatriation. Why can't I get this straight? Protection of streams and rivers. So in both communities, that was a big theme. And knowledge about nature that is encoded in their crafts. So just like there's a lot of knowledge about nature that is encoded in their languages, which are disappearing very fast, they are also encoded in their crafts. So crafts are like another type of language, and one that we have to support if we want to preserve that knowledge about nature. And so doing a comparison also of the organizations themselves, Fundarencia was doing community-based conservation through the PES program, and Ecotrust was doing community-based economic development through this program, but in the end, what they were really doing was creating natural economies. So supporting economies that are sustainable economies, that relate to environmental sustainability. These are some, I thought that was a really meaningful way to partner with indigenous communities on economic development, because the neoliberal modern economy depletes natural capital, and we need sustainable economies that don't deplete the natural capital, so that we live off the interest instead of depleting the actual capital. So we need new ideas for economies, and I'm not going to go through all of these, but here you go. There's not a deficit of new models being put forward. It's a huge explosion in the intellectual movement, is how to shift from the growth model to alternative or post-development economies. And so there's all these, you know.
What does GDH stand for in the bottom left?
Does anybody know? Gross domestic happiness.
Which one do you like best?
So I use natural economies.
That's the one you'd recommend?
That's, can you see that book, Karla? Yeah, I mean, they're all different, but all the same. You know, they're all, so I use it because I really like the book that Spencer Beebe wrote, and he calls it Natural Economies. But these overlap in so many ways. Some are more radical, some are less. But the point is that indigenous economies are well positioned to lead the transition to this new economic paradigm for reasons that we have discussed, and we can come back to that. But mostly it's because indigenous economies, like if they decide to integrate with the market, for example, that's not the end of the story. That is the beginning. They are at the beginning because they're going from subsistence economies, sustainable economies that have lasted for thousands of years, that have played well with the environment, to integrating in a way, we don't know how it's going to look, but it's under their own terms. So they're at the beginning of a very interesting process. And how would it look? So it's funny that Xiaomin mentioned Airbnb, because we are entering the third wave. The first wave was the agricultural wave. The second wave was industrialization. And the third wave is like the technological wave. And maybe many indigenous communities can skip the industrialized phase altogether and just go straight into the third wave, which is the technological wave, in ways like this. So now we see teepees competing with Hiltons, and you were talking about that. And that is a very interesting concept, I think. These are just other things that I didn't get into that I thought were really interesting and worth the research, so maybe other ideas for future students. The relationship between entrepreneurship and conservation, the relationship between supporting the crafts industry and conservation. Yeah, you can come back to conclusions are everyone is needed, and there's no single approach to sustainability. So that doesn't let us the hook, like, they lead the way, you know, like, no, we need everyone. And many different tech fixes, cultural fixes, you know, we need everything. As individuals, though, to give you something more concrete, we could reduce our ecological footprints and purchase legitimate, and I put fair trade, but also direct trade indigenous goods would be a good way. Is it proven? No, but everything is experimental right now. Nothing is proven. We thought that, like, fortress conservation was a good idea, maybe not so. So we can play with these things. These are ideas. As organizations, we can partner with locals and indigenous peoples for conservation and economic development on their terms. So for example, at the Patel College of Global Sustainability, this is the last slide. As the Patel College of Global Sustainability, we are in South Florida. We have the Seminole and Miccosukee tribes right next door, and we have no relationship. We are a new college, but it's something that we need to be thinking about and you know, putting on the table at some point, because our paths may be more similar than we think, and those types of partnerships create synergies. And supporting indigenous economies is a legitimate, though experimental, conservation strategy. I believe that. And that's what I was trying to show here. Why? Because when you empower indigenous economies, you will help them strengthen their land rights. You will address poverty issues, and you will further their political initiatives, which we have seen, because of their core values, will most likely lead to sustainable development. Thank you.
For still being here, we have another presentation by Karla Kemp. Her experiences in Italy, Sicily, and so forth. I'm her supervisor, and so we've been working very closely together. And we also have a co-supervisor, Ron Kevin. I forget him. But there were some things that he answered, that questions he asked, I could not answer. So I'm very happy that you have co-supervision for this. But anyway, I'll let you start your presentation, and looking forward to hearing what you did while you were in there.
Did a lot. It was kind of a three-stage process. I wanted a definitive project to be involved in it. I want to have a scientific background. Then I also helped to develop some other programs. So it's going to be kind of a three-stage process here. Changed the title to make it more consumer-friendly that way, because it was quite complex. More or less, I studied sustainable practices in viticulture, so I worked with the vineyards there and wineries. In fact, what I didn't know until I got there and spent some time with my family, one of my cousins is a sommelier, and the minute I mentioned one of the organizations I worked with, his eyes got really big, because it turns out that they happen to be the number one winery in the world right now. Wow. So that was an amazing coincidence. I actually went, let's see which direction we're going here. Oh, this computer's gonna lock up on me. Okay, I went to Italy with a program called Sustain. Last year, I did a local winery sustainability assessment, and so I kind of developed off of that and found an organization over in Italy, which was of particular interest to me because my family is from there, and I have a desire to go and live there for a couple of years, just for the cultural side of it alone, to get that historical background familiarly. So we discovered this organization called Sustain, which is also organized with the Universitat Catholica del Sacro Cuore, so University of the Sacred Heart. And this is the Piacenza location, works primarily with agriculture. They are the Roman capital of agriculture during the Roman Empire. So they are the leading research organization and college for all of the world, and the biggest funded one as well, and the original research college. So, but that's primarily based out of Milan. This is their Piacenza branch. And he has an organization called Sustain. I worked with Tori Capri, and he is a professor in pesticide soil impacts. And we, through a Viva project that they created with the Ministry of Land and Sea for Italy, started working with soil sustainability, vineyard sustainability down in Sicily. This project has already been established. And it started in 2011, it's a national project, and it was started by, if I can get this to go, I think it's gonna keep freezing up on me. I really saw. Planeta, Plantations. That was the leading winery in the world. Tasca de Muerta is the actual winery that started this program because they were interested in sustainability for being able to improve the quality of their product while maintaining their land, which in its own sense will maintain their community because they only hire their locals. They actually have arrangements with all of the regional farms and such, and they have contracts, and they have to go up to their standards as well of the sustainability and their environmental impacts and their quality to be able to utilize their product to create the wine that they need. There's no way that they can do enough vineyard of their own quality, of their own product, to get the demand, to meet the demand that they have. So they work with local organizations. So it's to their benefit to pursue sustainability for the community as a whole. Although it does have a rather interesting background dealing with the mafia and such, so which just more recently got cleaned up by this most recent family. So it's kind of their way of trying to piggyback the community in a way. Planetto was the second part of the time in Sicily, and both organizations were really amazing. Problem statement was to assess the existing dust management practices, if there were any, and to test soil samples for potential impact of the use of agrochemical application to the surrounding waterways via drift, runoff, and transference. Drift is like an airborne runoff, clearly a water issue. Transference, which a lot of people miss or aren't aware of and don't address, is actually, for example, from the machines that spray the application, from your maintenance tractors, your cars just driving through, people, your equipment that you're using. It's an area that's usually ignored just through lack of awareness. The objectives that I pursued while I was conducting my research, this was just a little bit of the impact that had gone on, was establishing sustainable best management practices, if they had any, irrigation runoff impacts, fungicide and pesticide applications, and really I thought this was going to go much faster. Long-term exposure, drift and mechanical transference impacts, are the primary objectives. Let me give you a little background here before we keep going on, because you can keep an eye on this stuff in the background. 10 days before we'd gotten to Sicily, they'd had a major storm that was really a 100-year storm for them. And in this part of, I almost want to say the country, it's its own entity. In the northern part of Sicily, they got literally, I think ultimately around, 97 meters of rain, or sorry, 90 millimeters of rain in an hour and a half, and an additional like 20 millimeters for the rest of the day. So it was getting more like a foot of rain. And they don't get rain at all in the summer, like none. So this ground is incredibly dry, which is actually what the wines prefer, and what the vines prefer, because it's really prolific in fungicide. Which is a big problem for wines. This is why they like the dry territories. But suddenly they had this like a foot of rain in a day, which they've never in their history had. And so it did dramatic problems. That big ditch that you saw, yeah, was like a foot and a half deep before that. And that was about 5 feet deep. Okay, so just know what's going on. Okay, so my research questions are: current best management practices affected on local waterways and runoff due to target-based pesticide application. Non-target pesticide drift and runoff is really an important part with the transport. Working with what's called connectivity is like where the roads come together, and people not thinking about when it rains, significant rains, then that will go somewhere. And right at the bottom of the hill was a lake that they used for irrigating the vines. So as you're applying this pesticides, fungicides, any other agrochemicals, it will accumulate in these areas. So it's your non-target areas. Does existing irrigation practices influence runoff, drift, and transport? And whether or not existing anti-pest management practices influence that as well, both in targeted and non-targeted areas. This is a memory issue. Is the TOPS broadest tool effective for landscape types in non-targeted areas? What the TOPS broadest tool is, they're actually utilizing the different kinds of vines, the different territories, as to whether or not the balance for the appropriate amount of irrigation, the appropriate amount of water that's used while they're applying the fungicides and such. Tasca de Muerta, for example, only did their applications at night, and they did not use any pesticides whatsoever. They used natural pesticide, a natural pest management through like combating insects, things of that manner. And they only applied their chemicals at night so that there would be actually a higher level of humidity, which would allow it to stay on the vines and settle and be less exposure to people who were working with it. And then less chance of wind as well. The wind is usually calmer in the middle of the night. So they did all their stuff at night. So there is an evaluation of whether or not their practices were actually working. An additional layer of sediment pond buffering and possibly a vegetative ditch promote better dissolution and degradation of pesticide management. In other words, would it keep it from going into the lake water that then is being used afterwards, purify the water, both in non-targeted and targeted areas? And will existing practices satisfy the EU requirements? Because they have a giant EU requirement, but it's very vague as well. But they're trying to see if they can lead the way and set standards, and if it's going to help improve the local waterways and non-targeted areas. It's funny, I swear. Maybe. I was actually working with a PhD student from Switzerland, one of Professor Capri's students, and she was working on creating, she's going to different types of farms to create a system to test for slope management for their irrigation practices, if they should be changing their practices for irrigation based on the steepness of their slope. She'd gone to many other kinds, including soybeans, corn, wheat, different countries of the world, and this was an application to be able to work in an arid area and also a vineyard area, which is a very different classification, and to see whether or not that this was going to be possibly an important tool for the wineries. And then we're almost done. Our current MET practices, boys, delays, not to my benefit. Our current practices with the machineries and the maintenance practices working for them, are they effective? Significance of this is based on the EU Directive 2009, which requires a national action plan to create targeted quantitative objects, timetables, and guidelines to minimize the impacts on the surrounding environments. However, they pretty much say create it. They don't tell you what to do. They don't set any mandates or whatever. So this company, I'm sorry, this organization, which is actually a group of 9 wineries at this point, is voluntary. That's led by Tasca Domerta and Planeta, are trying to create a system to take it forward and improve best management practices and reductions in the use of pesticides, and reducing environmental impacts with the crops, maintenance and performance and such, and increasing the triple bottom line in that way. I think we've completely missed a slide entirely somehow. Okay. So the methodology I used was using soil samples and sediment samples, went on site and climbed a lot of hills. It was very hot, 90 degrees in the Mediterranean at the time. Soil assessments utilized the Xiaomin hand drill, so we actually took core samples out of the ground, visual soil assessments and hand texturing methods. Photography, videography, and cell phone. We were using GPS and an inclinometer to be able to measure the actual steepness of the slope, the soil and sediment samples. I actually personally went to the university in Piacenza and did a bunch of sampling with a variety of equipment. I tested heavy metals, pH values, mercury, total organic carbon, inorganic carbon, total phosphorus, and total nitrogen, which are all major indicators of possibly having needing to take the second step to test for specific pesticides or fungicides in the majority of the case with the vineyards. So it was quite interesting. I couldn't do it all because not everything was on site. So my results, this is actually the Taskel Demerna site that got such distinct flooding, which I find interesting that it was the north part of the island because the south part of the island got nothing in that same major storm. It's not that big. but this is the lake that we were speaking of, and this is a lake that they use for irrigation. It's supposed to be a secondary lake, and up here to the right is supposed to be a primary lake for runoff from the other areas that then utilizes best management practices and going through kind of a cane-filtered area to move into the secondary to some natural cleaning. And that original one's walls broke down and is a big mud flat right now, just a great big mud flat. But this, they did a video of it literally 1 month before we got there, like 2 weeks before the storm. So they did this great big video about showing their sustainability and all their practices and such. And so I had the benefit of being able to look to that and see the comparison and do a comparative in that way. So I wasn't only working with this, but I found it interesting. This is all mud. All that's mud. And that little island there didn't exist before. That's all from this upper area. I took samples. There was actually, when I came out that morning, the first morning, they were actually harvesting this field right here. And they'd already moved over to this area. So I actually got to take samples off the actively harvesting tractors and their tires and the area where they've left mud tracks and such. A million pictures. And I found, so ultimately, this is just kind of an overall based on time between both Planeta and Taskel Demerna. Elevated phosphorus levels quite high, like up to like 200 times higher than they should be. Borderline alkaline pH excess. Vineyards like a more of an alkaline level, but it's kind of maxes out at like 8. And I got a lot of like 8.2, 8.5, so almost too high, too much. So it's probably something to pay attention to. But the pH is significant with some of your other tests. Some nitrogen levels were high, which is a matter of balancing the soil for the benefit of the grape versus the vine itself. The most significant thing that I found is that grape discharge from the trimmer shop in the storage ground area and the rear discharge part of it that was actually in the agricultural center was off the charts. So it tells you because, and I didn't put it in these pictures, I've got a million pictures, I literally have 10,000 pictures, so you guys are getting a very abbreviated version of this. When they harvest, they leave their vines all over. When they do their trimming, which they do at least 3 times a season, they leave the vines on the ground. And then between rain and irrigation, just natural accumulation into the ground is your transference right there. So they're clearly having high dose because I was off the charts with all of the major categories for this particular one. And then the other one that was ridiculous was in the effort to be more sustainable, Planeta has created this, and you'll see a picture later, this giant pit of leftover pesticides and chemicals. So they didn't just throw it, they just ditch it down the water. They created this giant pit with this pad for their trucks to back up onto and empty. And they're simply waiting for equipment from Bear to be able to process it and neutralize it so that it's environmentally friendly. But in the meantime, it's still sitting there. Now, my point was, I've seen many, many trucks run around. Never have you seen a truck, including a gas truck, not leave a trail. So I was looking at it, and I thought, well, this pad kind of angles back towards the road, which then goes into this ditch that goes around the corner and straight to their pistachio fields. So I thought, you know, I'm going to test here. That one as well was off the charts. I was actually kind of surprised that the grape discharge was a little bit higher than it. They were both significant areas because clearly it was something they weren't thinking about, their storage area as opposed to their field. So definitely in the transference area is something we need to think about. This field to the right is Taskel Demerna, and this is all runoff from that storm that came in down in like 3 major areas, all from this vineyard field up there, in which the runoff patterns were literally like a foot deep. And they cut between the vines even. They didn't just follow the roads. It was just whew, and it came down. This is a neighbor's wheat field, by the way. So it definitely impacts the community and impacts your neighbors. And it goes down to what's called the Tal Wag, which is a natural a water source that's created kind of at the base of the valley. But it went down into their orchards as well. And then it went into the community waterway. So it shows the significance of the potential. But you'll notice on the right here, there's not really any more. And if you were to see the rest of the picture, there's nothing in this part of the hill. And that's because above it is olive groves and terracing. They've got terraces up there and nothing created the problem. Terracing. Literal terracing for best management practice. So I found that interesting that they hadn't utilized more. more of that. But so they used basic to nominal use of best management practices actually based on those videos. They had very little, they had a little bit, but like a single layer, single row of something that was sparsely planned. Did not see the grassland that they said was there, the grass barriers and such. Their top sporatus tool is actually really appropriately used. I thought that was a really positive reaction to what they had going on. But a lot of their other best management practices, for example, their no-till areas, were isolated to one or two fields in the far back corner where they were still evaluating it. And I thought at this point, it might be better to take it out of the evaluation stage considering the way that many times throughout the island, I was asked about climate change impacts and how this was going to be affecting them. And clearly, it's not something in the future. It's something that's active right now. So, but these are many of the phases that they were experimenting with. No-till practices, terracing. They didn't really use grass barriers like they should have. Steep slopes were prevalent. I mean, they were literally 17%. A steep slope is considered more than 5%, so extremely steep. And so they need to work on that practice. The problem with that is that the reason they do that is because of the equal exposure of the different sides of the vine to sun throughout the day and throughout the different seasons of the summer, because they don't really grow in the winter, they come back. So that's really creates a problem there. And then climate change threats. But with climate change, they're really going to have to start adapting what they're doing. So the conclusions from that.
Yes.
Are that current best management practices are providing flexibility for the different needs of the vineyards, because the vineyard in the north is very different from the vineyards in the south. So it gives you some adaptability, but they really do need to increase the size and use of buffer zones, possibly using water gardens, deep vegetative basins and such, to offset the steep slope and to be able to control its impact on the waterways, being that lake or local areas that are, you know, creeks and beds and such. Wide vegetated strips and such to help deal with sedimentation potential. So in conclusion, the increased use of winter rotational crops for farming to hold the soils down, no-till practices need to be taken to more active status. This is actually the trimmer that I was telling you about and where I took the samples from that were off the charts. This is the pesticide pad I was telling you about. But it actually, I watched a guy just to the left here washing his personal car, which then made the water come down, connect right there, around the corner, and this is what was at the end. And right beyond that was the pistachio fields as well. So, anyway, they need to take a look at their agricultural centers themselves and see how it's where that runoff is going and how possibly they're transferring to other tractors and then communicating that out onto the fields, because there were big ponds that all the other tractors would go through and then dry on and take with them, etc. So, and they weren't used just in one field, you know, it was multiple fields. And some of the equipment is also used for like tomatoes and to deal with the grape or the olive groves and such. So this is the same irrigation tool, the dashboard that they were creating to deal with the steepness. Ultimately we decided more or less it was actually really good for a variety of the farming farm uses, other kinds of farms, but it really wasn't so applicable to the vineyards just because of the vine demands. So it's kind of, it was important to create, to do an assessment for it, but it's probably not so effective for this particular industry. It doesn't have enough options for the different vine needs based on weather patterns and, you know, their sun exposure issues. Ultimately, the information that she took dealing with hard pan and their till practices, etc., every time they go over the vines and go over a certain space, in the exact same space, every single time and uniformly throughout like the 9 different vineyards that we went to total, most of them didn't fit my criteria, so we didn't do all, I didn't do testing and all the, they literally had a hard pan about 18 inches, which that's as far as any water's ever going. So if there's getting a big rain like they had, it's all gone, like it did. So impaction was a big issue. So there's a level of that was actually good. This is all from the fields. So you can also see it's not just an island there, it's actually sitting on mud. So I suggest that they do a third-party analysis of their agricultural centers and also test this lake. We couldn't do water testing, we didn't have the facilities for it. I did take samples, but I think it would be important to test for that, because one of the results that I got was the fact that at Tosca del Muerta, all of the natural chemistry that's supposed to be there was well below the level of what it was supposed to be, which means it all ran off with the big rain. And it's all probably sitting right there in the lake. So Lord knows if there's any fish left in there or what else is there, but it's probably significant to pursue and check it out. They also need to assess the soil impact of this is seeming a little bit out of the ballpark, but this is a recommendation. I was originally going to test the vineyard that they had right on the water in Caparina, down in Memphis with Planetta, and we weren't able to get there. But part of why I bring it up as well is one of their vineyards, they had to completely redo due to rip it out entirely and put new plants in because they did well watering and they got seawater. So they're looking at saltwater intrusion. And that was already something that I was wanting to study with the olive grove. So possibly in the future, considering this is quite literally maybe 10 miles away, they should be looking into the saltwater intrusion potentially on the olive grove that's literally right on the water as well for their estuary activity. Because they've been actually renovating and restoring their estuary area. So sustain, in general, by continually assessing the conditions and actively self-propelling new and advanced sustainability practices, will most likely be successful with both the community and the companies. So they're doing a good job. They're open to all of these other experiments, people coming in and doing their testing, and possibly looking for new resources and new solutions, which is great. Viva is actually how sustain started. And it was a viticulture assessment done by the Ministry of the Environment, Land and Sea. And their objective was to establish a common methodology for the environment, social, and economic sustainability assessment in the wine sector using four indicators, which is really what Sustain is based off of. The interesting thing is I got invited to a executive training program that they have. So I spent a week in Cremona, which was not in my original plans. I spent a week in Cremona and I actually got a sustainable vineyard management certified to vineyard through this. And boy, did I learn a lot of Italian because it was all in Italian. Unfortunately, it's actually based mostly on sustainability project or processes that we've spoken about here. And most of their sustainability terms are actually based on American terms. So I'd done a lot of translating for them already, so I knew about the product and I was able to kind of ignore them. And I wrote all the Italian phrases down and did a lot of translating during that period of time. And then we got a big surprise at the end. We actually went to Expo and we hosted what was called a coffee session where we actually got the public involved and gave a big speech and a collaboration. And then afterwards, they had one of the preeminent sommeliers there and they did a big wine tasting for us. And it was funny because there was a bunch of other people that kind of kept following us in and I thought, are you supposed to be part of this, you know, because I know we're doing something special, like, are they sneaking in? But it turned out that there was major vineyard owners, including the owners of, like, Ernest and Giulio Gallo, like, the owners. And I was like, wow, I'm so glad I didn't say anything. But it was really cool, and actually, one of my classmates was one of the vineyards, and actually had his vineyard in this giant wine facility. Italy, being the hosting country, had the most, you know, and they had this big wine pavilion essentially, and you got to take your wine. You gave away wine. It was very expensive apparently. He put it for about 5 months, so I can't do it anymore. I didn't even show me where it was. But afterwards, up at the very top, completely glassed in area, they had the sommelier do all this presentation for us, and they actually gave us certifications, which we didn't expect, so it was kind of cool. We're like, oh, look at that. But that's the basis for this program that I went to, which was really quite interesting. And I met a lot of people who were consultants who worked in different industries, agricultural PhD people, just people of all varieties. Was really interesting. And then the final part is a semi-conference, or congress is what they call it there. This is only the second one. It's a biannual organization, a meeting. It's dealing with the supply chain management of the wineries and the vineyards. And the first one was in Napa Valley 2 years ago in 2013. And in April, I started acting as an executive on this and an officer and helping plan and organize the speakers, the stakeholders that were involved, what we did. This was held in Milan the first week of November, and 85% of the wine industry was here. So it was really quite interesting. We had leading industry speakers. We even pulled from Starbucks because of their practices, using their Indigenous people and using their hold with the community and the relationships and such, and how it can be transferred into the vineyard industry. So plain old supply chain management. We had stakeholder roundtable discussions. We actually invited, I got one of the professors here with our food industry, who's also Italian and did some of her studies in Italy, to go and be a stakeholder there. So she was able to give some feedback, which was great. And so it was a great relationship. I have a video embedded in there, but I don't think it's going to take. That was us, actually, one of the Tasco de Marta people, and he's commenting on this in my conference. But considering these delays, I don't think the video's going to take. I tried to play it on there a minute ago, but it didn't take. So ultimately, the concepts and the results, I put in a summary. It's really based on the concepts of sustainability and the validity to the industry. Both the SEEP conference in Cremona, as well as this, had to do a lot with educating these people in sustainability and what it was, and whether or not they felt like this would be a benefit to their industry. And they all agreed, this is overall a big, raging, welcoming embrace. Communication is an advancement of sustainability in the wine industry, educating people, being able to target both the producers, the supply chain people, as well as the consumers. It was also really important to establish a universal language so people could talk to each other and know what to expect. And the consumers need to be educated as well. Sustainability context is site-specific and industry-specific, so once again, every country's got a little bit different vines, a little bit different agricultural areas and such. So it needs to be flexible enough to work with the different demands, but there needs to be kind of an overall expectation set. Ethics and how they play an essential role in building sustainability and the importance of sensory analysis. Sensory analysis, I find it interesting to keep using that word, is really flavor, the taste. If you can't sell your product, then you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot. Although I'm surprised because the impetus is that they're afraid they'll do too much environmentally that will diminish the flavor, and that just doesn't kind of make sense to me, you know? But anyhow, this was actually the way they had all of the award-winning, the top wines lined up, and these are all the sustain, this is the sustain wall, in fact, and this is the way they're labeling their bottles. Is that's actually, you can scan that with your phone and get the background of that particular winery and what they do and their practices. And it shows, they do landscape, air, water, and environment, and gives you all the breakdowns of what their excel at, what their levels are, so you can actually say what's sustainable and what's not. It's actually providing the information. One of the questions we addressed was, why do we need sensory evaluation as a part of the sustainability and the evaluation of wines? Is it because it provides a connection with the consumer, educates them, builds their vocabulary, et cetera, and increases the diversity of the wine. And the Cremona event that I went to was in the process of creating these properly trained experts to work with the sensory analysis and work with sommeliers and such to create the better studies and surveys and figure out how to make it work for the industry in general. Factors other than sensory characteristics that were important were also cultural and culinary habits. As you know, food is paired with wine in different ways, so it's important. Climatic conditions as single.
And his supervisors were George Filipidis and Grant Gabriel Michael. A lot of good stuff in here. Looking forward to hearing it.
Not letting me launch?
It might still be deleting. You can close like Google if you want to. I opened it to do the video, but I didn't use it, so that could eliminate some of your issues.
Just hit F5.
Say it again?
F5.
Where
Right, and then the space bar will move it for you.
You have the clicker.
Or the clicker, or whatever.
Here we go.
We'll get it on?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Before we start, I would like to publicly acknowledge the help of my supervisors, who Dr. George Philippides, because of another meeting that he cannot be here, and also Dr. Cabret that I saw earlier. But besides my supervisors, I would also like to acknowledge the help of a few other people here within the college, Dr. Dorsey, and also Mr. Wendell Pape, and also from the USF Study Abroad Office, particularly Ms. Nancy DiBella, and also Mr. Preston Drain for the help in getting this project completed. I call it my tri-continental experience, the great story. As you can see here, I have to go three different continents to get this program completed. Let's continue so we can see.
Wait for it, it's the memory, I'm sure. I guess the mic
is given. There's some frozen in the background. Mm-hmm. My capstone project in the water energy, it was in the water energy nexus, and what I will be covering is what was my project about, where did my project take me, the key findings, some recommendations, potential for replication of the Brazilian system in other countries, and also lesson learned from my project.
Yes.
The official title of my project was the Water Energy Nexus in the Context of the Brazilian Experience with Sugarcane Ethanol, Challenges for Water Resources Management, Food Supply, and Economic Development in a Carbon-Constrained World with a Rapidly Increasing Population. It is indeed a long one. So we will try to, what was it really about? Trying to shorten it. It was about understanding how increased sugarcane ethanol production in Brazil impacts fresh water. That's basically the shortened version of it. Brazil is the world's biggest producer of bioethanol from sugarcane. Now, the United States is the first producer of bioethanol, but it is from corn. Brazil is the number one in terms of bioethanol production from sugarcane. Brazil is a water-rich country with a lot of natural resources as well, but it is also home to sensitive resources like the Amazon rainforest and also many plant and animal species that are rare that we don't find in other places. Brazil is a very populous country. It is the fifth most populous country in the world. It is the sixth largest economy, but it has a different development pathway, different from other BRICS nations, such as China, South Africa, India, and the other ones. So that's why I was very interested in Brazil in terms of the way they want to develop their economy and what they have adopted. And also, I wanted to see how the Brazilian experience, or to gauge how the Brazilian experience can be replicated in other areas, particularly developing countries that has similar characteristics with Brazil in terms of tropical weather, soil, and so on. So where did my project take me? Basically from North America to two other continents. I went to Italy, especially Rome, at the FAO headquarters, where I spent a few weeks at the headquarters. I didn't have a chance to travel to the countryside because I stayed mostly in Rome and then only do the back and forth from my the Catholic seminary where I stayed to the FAO headquarters for my couple of weeks in Italy. I also went to Sao Paulo, Brazil, and visited quite a few cities that we will see later. Rome, Italy. FAO headquarters, and then the cities that I visited in Brazil are Sao Paulo. There is the state of Sao Paulo, but also there is the city of Sao Paulo. Ribeira Preto, Santo Genro, and Pentagelas, all of them in the state of Brazil, of Sao Paulo. The different sites I visited, and also those are the different stakeholders, the different people that I obtained information from. One of them is the big one is UNICA. UNICA is the Brazilian Sugarcane Association, and he is kind of the main body that speaks for the industry and visit for the sugarcane and our industry. And also I participated in the Fenasucro and Agrocana Fair, which is a sugarcane energy fair for about 3 days, where I collected a lot of information and also met a lot of business people. I also visited the Vera Alcohol sugar and ethanol plant, which is in Pitangueras. Those three, those three dots up here are the different cities. They are not so close, they're about 1 hour away from each other, but they are in the general location, away from Sao Paulo. I visited the Centro de Cana Research, which is a research station for mainly for sugarcane, and also had a lot of information gathering meetings with my host and their contacts in Brazil. Key findings of my research: a brief overview of the Brazilian sugarcane ethanol sector. This table on the right of here shows you the different numbers in terms of sugarcane growers, the number of hectares planted, 9.5 million, and also the amount of sugarcane processed. Still learning this clicker over here. Okay, 650 million tons for the year 2014-2015, and providing over a million jobs. Like I say, Brazil is a big sugarcane ethanol producer, the number one sugarcane ethanol producer. It's a very well-developed industry. They've been doing it since the 1970s, so they really developed the know-how of producing ethanol from sugarcane. They also have strong national policy support. It started as a government program, and up to now, they have in place a lot of policy frameworks that really support the ethanol production in Brazil. This is a picture of the price while I was down there of ethanol versus gasoline, 1.99 versus 2.29, that's in Brazilian rate.
When were you there?
I was down there in August to September.
It's dropped more since then. The price of gas dropping.
Well, indeed, this year they have a very good year in terms of the price of ethanol, particularly hydrous ethanol, because they have a difference between the two kinds. The anhydrous ethanol is the one that they mix with gasoline, but the hydrous ethanol is the one that you could put straight in your car. And then this year, they have a very bomb and the use of the hydrous ethanol. Before I continue, I would like to make those points about sugarcane production in Brazil, because I know it's a big concern about sugarcane expanding into area, sensitive area that may affect environmental, that may cause environmental destruction. The land use in Brazil, it is governed by the 2009 government guidelines, whereby they define areas that can be used for sugarcane production. And currently, they only use only 0.5% of the national land for ethanol production. For sugarcane, it's about 1%. But the all the sugarcane they use is not only for ethanol. It's usually more likely a good half and half for sugar and ethanol production. So not all of the sugarcane grown goes to ethanol production. Only 0.5% of ethanol production. And also one can compare that sugarcane, the amount of land used versus other one. Sugarcane up here, soybeans about 21 million hectare, and corn is about 14. So sugarcane is not like the biggest land user in Brazil.
I'm sorry, does that include like urban, this is strictly agricultural?
No.
But when you say land in current use, it's?
The 0.5% is 0.5% of the land in Brazil.
0.5%. But land in current use up there, is that just agricultural use or is that including cities?
No, that's total land. Total land. When you say total land.
When you move down like a native vegetation and then land in current use?
Or the land in current 30%, yes.
That's
not so much for sugarcane.
That's agricultural?
That's what land that they're using. Most of it over here is native vegetation. Right here, 65.
But when you say in current use, what use? Like agricultural?
Agriculture over right here.
Yeah.
Yes.
Other uses is probably use. City.
Agricultural.
Agricultural.
Okay, and then the rest would be like urban areas.
Urban
areas, okay,
correct. But 0.5% of the total land is what is used for ethanol production.
Okay.
Yeah. And also wanted to show this map over here. Usually one of the critics of sugarcane production is that they are encroaching into the Amazon rainforest. And this map here shows the main center of sugarcane production. One of it is in the south central area, which is around the Sao Paulo, which is the main center of sugar production in Brazil. This area produces about 90% of sugarcane ethanol in Brazil. And then the northeast produces the rest. Sao Paulo, the state alone, produces about 60% of the national production. Sao Paulo state alone. Wanted to make those points before we move. Key findings. My research was about water and energy. So I went looking at water use both in the field and also in the plant. In the field in Sao Paulo, most of the production is rain-fed. So they really don't use that much irrigation water. But in the plain, in the northeast, it is a bit different because the northeast is drier than around Sao Paulo. So they need more irrigation. But I didn't have a chance to travel to the northeast. I only stay in Sao Paulo. In the plain, when they make ethanol or sugar, that's where most of the water use is taking place. Currently, this is a breakdown of the water usage within the sugarcane ethanol industry in Brazil. And I would like to call attention to a couple areas. One of them is the cane washing, 10%. When they brought the cane in from the field, they wash it before it goes into the process. And about 10% of the water used in the plant is used to wash the cane, and we'll get to that one later. Other areas that are primed for reduction, we see that 26% in sugar concentration and also the cooling. These three areas constitute the largest areas that are using water in the plant.
What was sugar concentration?
When they make the sugar, it's coming as a liquid. When
oh,
they
okay.
dry it down from the sugar cane, so they have to concentrate it. So they do a lot of process. It's a very involved process.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very big industrial process. Another area is the water balance and the industry. This probably pretty small for you to see, but currently they are using about 22 meter cube per ton of sugarcane. That's the amount of water that they are using. But at the end, the water consumption, the water that they don't recycle, is about 2 meter cube per ton. If you go over here, it's about 2 meter cube per ton of cane. If you go down to, because they do like three different things with the sugar cane down there, sugar, ethanol, and also electricity. Those are the main areas that they are focusing on.
Do you know, for 1 ton, is it roughly an acre, or do you know how many acres per ton, essentially?
Oh, it's about, the yield is about 80, yield now is about 80 ton per hectare. In Brazil. Different countries have different yields based on soil and also different varieties in different areas. The industry goal, they set a goal for themselves to lower that water consumption from 2 meter cube per ton to 1 meter cube per ton by 2020. That's the industry goal. This shows the water intensity of the different products. Like we have sugar, it's about 14 liters per kilogram. We have ethanol, it's about 23 liters of water for 1 liter of ethanol produced. So anyway, it's very water intensive.
Say that again.
23 liters of water to produce 1 liter of ethanol. Yeah. For sugar production, it's a bit less. But in actuality, they recycle much of the water. So the water that actually consumed is about 2 meter cube per ton. And this is this number that they're trying to reduce to 1 by 2020. Little note, 1 meter cube is about 1,000 liter or 264 gallons. Most of the units are in metric unit.
And you said 80 tons per hectare? 80
tons per hectare.
That's a lot of water.
Yeah. But again, especially in Sao Paulo, the fact that they have a lot of rain, they don't see the water usage.
However, early November, they announced to the city of Sao Paulo they had 45 weeks of water.
Correct.
Potable water, and that was it.
When you have this drought situation, then you have to deal with competition.
So how is that supposed to be affecting the operations here?
Well, two things, and I think we'll get to that one when we get to allocation of resources. I was asking, is there a legal framework to determine how water is allocated, and they don't have one in terms of who has priority, whether it would be agriculture, industry, or people. They don't really have one. They decide now that people need water, they will have water, but it's like there is no legal mandate to give priority to people. My recommendations, because the goal of the industry is to lower water usage. And they already set the goals of reducing it by half, from 2 meter cube to 1. And based on the other chart that I show you about the different percentage of the different faces that uses water, I would recommend that they achieve full mechanized harvesting. Because what they do is like they burn the cane, or they used to burn the cane before they cut it and bring it, and then they have to wash it before they send it to the process. But if they do mechanized harvesting, then they won't have a burned cane and they will not have to wash it. Or they can do dry cleaning, dry it with air or the stuff instead of using water. That will save a good 10% of the current water use in the plant. And also, I would recommend that they invest in technology that can reduce water use, both at the sugar concentration phase and also in the cooling phases. Now, I didn't investigate whether the technologies are there already to accomplish this. So that would be something else that need to find out whether the technologies are there and whether it is applicable in the plant. Another one will be to reuse recycled water as much as possible before discharge, meaning if it's not too dirty, if there is not a process that it can be used for, use it again before you actually discharge it. But not, they don't discharge the water into nearby river creeks or water bodies. They also, they use it, as we asked, for irrigation in the field. About one third of the field are irrigated with the vinasse, the byproduct of the ethanol production. Continued recommendations. Incorporate water use requirements with current land use management. The agroecological zoning that the government put out determine what kind of land is suitable for sugarcane growing. But it doesn't take into account water availability. So my recommendation would be to include water availability in that requirement. So you can say, if in this area you don't have that much water, you cannot produce sugarcane, because sugarcane is a very thirsty crop. It requires a lot of water. It's one of the thirstiest crops, thirstier than rice and even cotton. Using about 1,500 to 2,500 millimeters of water per year. Now, in the case of Brazil and Sao Paulo, where they have a lot of rain, it doesn't matter too much. But if you have to irrigate and have to find that water somewhere, then it matters. Or if there is strong competition, like when there is drought, that you have to compete with urban sector, then that's a big issue when you are using crop that use so much water. My recommendation would be to use plant with lower water requirement. Example of sorghum. This is the water requirement for sorghum, 450 to 650 millimeter. And other advantages, you have two crops per year. Now, the yield is low compared to sugarcane. But if you can grow it on marginal land and you don't irrigate, and you can get two crops per year, it may be economical to consider doing this one, especially in an area where you don't have enough rain and you can't grow sugarcane.
Can you discuss that real quick again? So
this is sugarcane, that's the water requirement. This is what sugarcane needs to grow.
Yeah, that was looking at the last box. I got it. Thank you so much. This is really interesting.
Yeah. And then put a price on water to encourage wise use. Currently, the farmers are not really paying for the water they use. And everybody kind of have their operations by a water bodies where they can draw water and use it. And then when I ask what is an illegal use of water, they say really there is none. As long as you have a license as a business to operate, you have the right to use the water. So one of my contacts and one of the plants say that now there is a proposal to start charging for water this year. So I think if they start charging for water, then companies will start thinking twice about how much of that water they use, because they have to pay for it. But up to now, they don't really pay, except if they are hooked up to some urban system. That's the only way they pay for the water. But in the field out there, in the country, they just use whatever water is available. In other recommendations that I see, it's to, for Brazil to consider moving bulk materials by train or trucks. It was amazing that 650 million tons of materials are being moved around, and almost all of it is moved by trucks on the road, not so much, not no train.
I had a question about that. It's kind of related. How's the public transportation system in Brazil?
Very good. Road transportation is very good. Yes, especially they have a bus. Road transport is very good. Bus system can take you from, I travel by bus.
Mm-hmm.
To the different cities, and they have a very reliable transportation. Inside the Sao Paulo, inside the city, they have the metro and they have bus system also.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very reliable. And then when I asked about why don't they have train to transport all those sugarcane, and I always thought it was mostly a political issue,
mm-hmm.
that the trucking industry has a lot of lobbying, and that's one of the things that's why they kind of kill the train.
That's
idea.
A train's got to go up here too, though.
But it would be a very good idea to move those stuff by train and instead of using trucks, because it's so much material, and Brazil is so large that it would make a lot of sense, especially for the environment.
Considering all the train derailments we've had here with the oil industry and such, do you think that's really
those are not like dangerous material they are moving. It's sugar cane. So if you
you're talking the cane itself, not the ethanol.
Well, I'm talking about sugar cane. That means they will move ethanol also, because they have to be economical. Once you move the sugar cane in, after alcohol is produced, you may have to move it out.
Mm-hmm.
But also it's a safety issue that everybody has to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
So even in the trucks, things may happen too in the trucks. It's just with the train, it's just at the biggest scale. Is there a potential for replicating the Brazilian experience in other parts of the world? Currently, we have more than 100 countries that are potential producers of sugar, that can produce sugarcane. And sugarcane can be grown all the way from Spain all the way to South Africa. And coincidentally, most of the developing countries are located in the global south, where there is a great potential for sugarcane. So is there a potential for other countries to adopt the Brazilian model? I say yes. And given the benefits to the environment and also to the economy that we can see with the Brazilian experience, I think many other developing countries should adopt the Brazilian model to green their transportation and also for the economic benefits that it really brings to Brazil, because they employed over 1 million people and also contributed quite a lot to the local economy, investing the petroleum dollars into the local economy. That's what I like about Brazil. Positive potential, from a historical perspective, I call it a sweeter end to a bitter colonial memory. Because the slaves were the ones that actually did heavy lifting back in the days when they were using slave labor to produce sugar for the crowns back in Europe. So now we see Brazil that takes that dirty colonial past and try to use it for good economic gain. And they have done a pretty good job at it. From small machines to bigger one, from the people, slave labor, now to great mechanized harvesting. They have done a pretty good job. It has pretty good positive environmental benefits and great potential for economic growth and rural development. Lesson learned. I didn't want to go and bother people so much with the actual content of the paper, because I know not everybody would be interested in all what is inside the paper, so I try and take it on a different angle, trying to pick what I think people may relate to. I end up having to do my internship in 3 different continents, and it wasn't good. The logistic nightmare is pretty bad. So my advice to all the students is like, be careful when you choose your internship site, because it could be a very big headache. And I guess other people who have done it in 2 different places also understand that. Global organizations are good, but bureaucracy is a major headache. I did mine with FAO, which is a big UN organization. The FAO headquarters in Rome is 8 stories high. It's a big and huge organization. I spent 2 weeks going up and down that building. I still didn't know the whole building. So you can easily get lost in there. And you really have to have somebody that guide you in there in order to make your internship productive. Otherwise, considering a smaller organization, you have more attention and it may be easier to do, because this one won't be. Foreign language skills are important. Not everybody cares about speaking English. I was lucky when I was in Rome, because I speak a little bit of French and a few words of Spanish also. So between English, French, and Spanish, I was able to get by, because I don't know much Italian. Mm-hmm. But my Spanish, my French, and my English helped me. If one can speak another language, that's pretty good. Or if one can practice before you go on internship, that would be pretty good. In Brazil, it was much more difficult because I don't speak too much Portuguese, but with my Spanish, I can really get by. But I guess I should say the Brazilians are not too helpful when you don't speak Portuguese. So I forget that quite quickly. Travel smart, parking, currency exchange, interaction with host. I had an experience going to Rome because I flew on standby because my visa, I get my visa late, so I flew on standby. And my check-in luggage didn't get there with me. But thanks to preparation over here from the study abroad folks in terms of what to do, and also I wasn't born yesterday, I know a thing or two, so I packed my carry-on good enough to give me like 2 days before my suitcase got, which was pretty good. Mm-hmm. Currency exchange, I know it is advised that you don't carry cash, but I am a bit old school, and I believe cash is king. Mm-hmm. So what I did was that I ordered some cash to my bank, the euro to go to Europe and rias to go to Brazil, and I can say it was it was very good, very handy to have cash that you can do transaction with. Now, not everybody can protect the cash money. It's another security risk, but if you know what you're doing, it could be very easy when you have cash in your hand instead of trying to do transaction by credit card or some other currency. Temporarily, assimilate into the culture and make friends that will last beyond the internship. I come back, but I have quite a few friends that I left in Rome because I stayed with in a Catholic seminary because I have a distant cousin from Haiti that is studying over there in Rome. So I get through that family friendship, I get to stay in there. And I met quite a bunch of people from different countries, made friends. Go back to Brazil, I also met quite a bunch of people that until now we are in contact and we're trying to do things together. So it's a good idea to try to assimilate into the culture where you do your internship. This is the pictures, some pictures from Rome. And I would like to put attention to that one up here, that fountain there. This fountain is dripping water 24/7. And I was shocked and I say, why don't they put a faucet in there that you can turn. This is good drinking water.
Is that in Italy?
That's in Rome.
Yeah.
And it's dripping water all the time. And then they're saying it's an old stuff way back to the Roman time. And people seem to be proud, historical stuff of it, instead of trying to say it's a waste. But in my view, it's a waste.
Because I can tell you most of them, though, and most in the other areas, I have actually gone to a spigot now. Added a spigot to it.
Yeah, because I was telling them, why did they do it? Because it kept running 24/7, and it just wasting the water. And it's good drinking water.
It's really good drinking water.
This is pictures of me. This is the Vatican down here that we visited, and also pictures at the FAO. 2015 was the year of the soils, so they have a whole lot of activities about soil. And Brazil, sugarcane, that's at the research center, that's at the fair, and those are part of my hopes in Ribeirão Preto. This is pictures of some of the sugarcane at the research center. That's it for my presentation, and now I will entertain any questions if you have any.